Zeit alle zogen an einem Strang. Man wollte eigentlich die schwule Revolution machen.
Es gab zu der Zeit die großen 1. Mai-Demonstrationen, wo wir dann auch als HW mitgegangen sind.
Die HW selber begriff sich als ein Sammelbecken von linken Homosexuellen. Da waren die Marxisten-Leninisten und da waren die Trotzkisten und da war der linke Rand der Sozialdemokratie. Da waren sogar ein paar FDPler mit dabei.
Und damals war ja natürlich die Zeit hochpolitisiert. Man wollte den Kapitalismus überwinden. Und man wollte natürlich an der Seite der Arbeiterklasse diesen gesellschaftlichen Prozess einläuten.
Es konnte uns ja durch die Mauer keiner entkommen. Dadurch hatten wir natürlich auch ein großes Geschäft. Das hat sich auch verändert. Es gibt jetzt zu viel Kneipen, zu viel Taxen, zu viel Opern. Das ist alles zu viel. Das kann da nicht alles laufen.
In meiner Anfangszeit, wir haben in Hotels gewohnt für 10 Mark am Tag. Es gab ja damals diesen Kudamm-Skandal, wo Transvestiten in der Pension verhaftet wurden. Noch in den 60er Jahren gab ja überall Razzien.
Mich hat man auch einmal mitgenommen vom Kleist-Casino in die Gurtaer Straße und fotografiert und Fingerabdrücke. Aber das Schärfste war, man legte uns jeden einzelnen große Fotoalben vor. Und dann sollte man sagen, wen man kennt und wen man nicht kennt. Und wenn die Fotoalben aufgemacht wurden, na, da waren aber Prominente drin.
Und wenn Razzia war, dann war nicht nur bei uns, sondern war ja im ganzen Viertel. Also alle Läden wurden kontrolliert. Und viele Schwule haben dann geheult, haben sich unter den Tisch, wir hatten ja noch lange Tischdecken. Ja. Weißt du, so bis runter, da saß du unter der Tischdecke und versteckt und guckten raus.
Und somit hat man ja also die jüngeren Leute, die in den Lokalen verkehrten, sowieso mitgenommen. Und das war ganz schlimm. Die Eltern mussten kommen und mussten ihre 19-jährigen Söhne abholen. Und dann waren die geoutet. Wo verkehrst du? Was bist du? Schwul bist du? Patsch, hat der Vater dem ein paar runtergeknallt. Und der Polizist, dieser Oberste, der das alles gemacht hat, der hat sich noch halb tot gelacht dabei. Und hat gesagt, ja, das ist richtig.
Era un sistema político nacional católico y la sexualidad no se tocaba, es decir, aquí no existía la sexualidad. Con respecto a no tocarse ese tema, tampoco se tocaba el tema de si había gays en las prisiones. Había una ley de la República que se llamaba Ley de Vagos y Maleantes y en esta ley no recogía la criminalización de la homosexualidad. La dictadura introduce ya a los homosexuales dentro de esta ley.
Y nos aplicaron esa ley, pues a nosotras también, pues sin tener nosotras culpa de nada de eso. Pues porque los travestis no, es que no, no, es que no éramos ni pues vagos ni maleantes. Después le cambiaron el nombre y se llamaba la Ley de Peligrosidad Social.
Lo curioso de esta ley es que el acto homosexual estaba penado no solamente fuera, sino también dentro de la propia casa, dentro de tu propia cama. Alguien te podía denunciar y entonces, bueno, la ley actuaba como si este escándalo público hubiera existido fuera, en plena calle.
Se llevaba a cualquiera por delante, sin necesidad de abogado, se le podía encausar, simplemente diciendo la brigada criminal de que eres peligroso para la sociedad y para ti mismo.
También había terapias de aversión, es decir, a los homosexuales se les pasaban imágenes masculinas y se les daban descargas eléctricas, o sea, estímulos negativos, con la supuesta idea de que se rehabilitaran o se curaran.
So maybe you just like want to give a little, or like tell us a little bit about the film and about your methodology, your research, and probably also about some problems.
Okay, thanks. My film is called Bones of Contention. Looks at the historical memory movement in Spain today. And of course, since you mentioned all these films I've made about LGBT history, of course my interest immediately went to where is the LGBT story within the historical memory movement. And it was a story I really knew nothing about. I started from zero. Really the first place that I turned to try and find out some information was to one of the characters in my film, who's here today, Anthony Ruiz, who's president of the Association of, I guess in English you'd say, ex-social prisoners, which doesn't really make sense in English, but it's non-political prisoners, it's LGBT prisoners who were imprisoned under Franco. And he had started doing some of the real groundwork to put the LGBT story into the historical memory of Spain. His work is very important, but for the most part, it was also the lesbian story, which was kind of hidden, was more, even more hidden, more deeply hidden. So to try and uncover that aspect, I had to speak with older lesbians, some of whom were very reluctant. They lived a whole life of silence. There's so much silence in Spain. There's silence about the entire Franco era, not just LGBT, every single thing. And so finding lesbians who wanted to talk about their lives, and it was difficult. And I had to find women who were really out and who were activists, the people who were used to speaking publicly. But in terms of problems, I think there is a woman who you hear in the film. You hear her story about, which if you've seen the film, you know, she talks about we were a little freer when we went camping, and she talks about we called each other booksellers and so on. She would not agree to be on camera in my film. So I had to find other ways to bring her story in. And respect her desire to stay private. But it's hard to imagine living with that kind of invisibility for so long. You're not going to turn around suddenly and agree to be in, you know, on the global stage. So that's probably a big limitation that I had to work with.
So you also included archive material in the film. In terms of queer archives, how is the situation in Spain? Is there one, and how is the access? Photos and films were just like private donations?
There is a queer archive in Barcelona, Casa Lambda. I did not really use much of it because most of the material, as far as I can understand, was kind of post-Franco. And I used personal archives, like for example, from Sylvie Reyes and Anthony Ruiz. Their personal photographs are in the film. I have photographs from this woman who refused to be on camera, but she was willing to let me use, yeah, I guess because other people in the photos are no longer alive and so on. So I have access to some personal photos, but mostly for me, in fact, not just for this film, but in my kind of career doing queer historiography, I've appropriated a lot of images that may or may not be queer images, but they involve looking at them through queer eyes, let's say. So a lot of the footage in the film, you see women walking on the street, looking at each other. Those are from mainstream archives. They were never identified as queer images, but I claim them as such.
Jochen, we see you even in the archive, working, researching in the archive in your film. Do you also want to tell us a little bit about the film, the content of the film, and your methodology? Like, how did you work archive material, and maybe also problems you've been confronted with?
There's kind of a lucky situation that in Berlin there's the Gay Museum, and I'm also working together with Karl-Heinz Steinle, who is a person who is a historian, and he worked in the Gay Museum, and he has access to a lot of people and heritages of people who were living or had their youth during the 50s and 60s, because this was his main field of research. So this was one good thing. The disappointment then was that there is not that much visual material in the end in the game museum, like of moving images. There are quite a lot of photos, but always sometimes when you look for something really, really special, sometimes it's not there. And you also don't find it in the regional archive, or sometimes it was a little bit sad, but no one to blame, that, that the materials weren't transferred as good as they could have been if there would have been more money behind, or people only dedicated to how do we have to deal with video, or how do we have to deal with film, because sometimes also film, the Super 8 materials, some of them, they already have this kind of a structure on it where you can see it's kind of a fungus on the Super 8 material, and you can't really restore them anymore. I was with this film and the film before, I was in the lucky situation that we had a TV involved. Usually I did my films a lot without television, but since the local broadcaster gave us access to their archive, we found quite a bit, but it was also tremendously little what they really have. It's very funny that you sometimes really find pearls, like even in the 60s, that there were like journalists doing things about gay or lesbian people in a way where you would say you could almost air this today, because it's really very, yeah, very on top of the time. And at the same time, 1 year later, you would find something else which is totally reactionary. And of course, it was very interesting to have this, because it showed like the view on gay and lesbian people throughout the media. And my editor, Thomas Keller, and me, we were, I mean, this time it was really a lot of work. But still, I think it's... Even in a city like Berlin, where you could think like already there was in the 1970s, there was this gay movement of Homosexuelle Aktion Berlin, which is like a group which was marching down Kurfürstendamm and Townsendstraße. Only they were filming it on Super 8. There's nothing in the archives of television. And it really took a lot of time until they did something. And then it was mostly only like maybe going to a nightclub and filming a show, or maybe filming for 2 minutes on the newsreel of a Christopher Street Day in this really horrible, horrible, horrible video techniques of the 80s and 90s, which nowadays we can't even look at. So there's very, very little. And the good thing was like that in the Gay Museum, some people really trust the Gay Museum, that their heritage and all what they have, even what they think which is not useful or no one would be of no interest to anyone, they give it to the Gay Museum, and the Gay Museum has the rights, but they also can limit it, of course, what can be done with that material, to give this to people who make films or do their research. And there were a couple of Super 8 things from the 50s and 60s from people who filmed their life, like their escapes to Italy or to Switzerland when there was still paragraph 175 in Germany, or when they were on Tegeler See, which is like a little resort, or like a lake you would go on a weekend, and all these things, and they are incredibly important. And what I only can say is like also the archives have to understand not to underestimate what moving images mean for bringing identification to gay and lesbian people, but also at the same time also value it in a way like that they get more access and means to like do it on a professional level, because you really have to deal with these materials in a professional level from the first point of transfer, and you know, not just transfer from a DVD to a super, you know, like what is done.
I mean, how do we fill those archives? You know, like I know there's a worldwide home movie day, I think every, it's like one day in October, many, many cinemas all over the world offer people, here it is Stiftung Deutsche Kinemathek and Arsenal, to bring old Super 8 films, and they can digitalize them, they can be archived as well. Would that be maybe an option to have like a queer home movie day where people could just like go and show their films, photographs, and let them digitalize them? Or, I mean, we are like in the lucky situation, the Schwul Museum is funded. Does something exist in the States like this, like officially funded archives that get money, not mentioning the situation, how it will become now, maybe. I don't even want to mention this name, but we are confronted with problems. But in general, is there funding for queer archives in the States?
There are a number of queer archives in the United States. There's a big one in Los Angeles called the One Institute. One Institute was one of the very first gay organizations in the United States, going back to way before Stonewall, and they still exist, and they have a big archive in Los Angeles. There's also a Lesbian Herstory Archive in Brooklyn, New York, which is quite large, which has a lot of personal collections. But again, like the One Institute, they don't have much moving image. And also, because they don't have the funding, they don't have the mechanism to preserve moving images, because it's not enough to have them. As Jochen pointed out, you need to be able to preserve them and also update them into more contemporary ways of seeing them, because a lot of these early video formats, for example, no longer exist, and film gets corrupted, and it gets mildewed, and it gets torn, and it becomes unusable. So you need archives with funding to preserve material and transfer it. And no, in the United States, there is no public funding for these archives. There's a LGBT collection at the New York Public Library. It started because the New York Public Library had a big LGBT exhibition and asked for donations, and then kept what was left from the exhibition to create an archive. And they have more resources than these more private, independent archives. However, they also receive no funding from the United States government, not just for the LGBT archive, for the library itself. It's incredible, but it's funded privately, even though the name is New York Public Library. It's funded by large benefactors. So we have a situation where, on the one hand, unfortunately, we have no public funding, but on the other hand, we're fortunate in that they can't cut the funding. So, you know, we're not going to get any money from this government, but then we haven't expected any. So.
And we found at least two photographs are from an archive, the gay and lesbian archive in Canada. For example, because there was a photographer who was here in the 70s, and he photographed things which no one photographed here, which was funny, you know.
I mean, I think we all agree that archives and queer history is important in order for kids, for us as well, maybe to find role models, people we can identify with as well, I think.
But one thing I would like to add is the money thing. The money thing is like, you could never, in Germany, for example, it's different maybe a little bit in the United States, you could never do an historic film with moving images without television, still, mm-hmm. without having television involved, because otherwise they would call up prices like 1 minute, €7,500, mm-hmm. and even other archives getting more and more in this kind of professional role, that with the viewers you have, like for a gay-themed or lesbian-themed documentary, you would never be able to raise this amount of money to get these excerpts. And in Germany, it's really, really tough that they're all under, under the rule of either the TV stations, which were publicly funded, but would sell them to us, like, you know, like sometimes 3 minutes would be the whole budget of a film. And on the other hand, there's the thing that you, now I lost my little point, but
can I just
you know.
Jump in of here course. For a moment? One thing I forgot to mention is there is an archive for queer moving images in the United States. It's called the Legacy Project.
In Chicago?
In Los Angeles.
Los Angeles, okay.
It's affiliated with the UCLA University of California in Los Angeles, film and television archive. So it's a funded archive, but it's a project within that. And people like myself and other queer filmmakers give our material to them to preserve it for future generations. So they have the means and the resources, and also the, like, the climate control. You have to you have to store this material a certain way. They have the ability to do that, and they have the ability because it's part of the university system. It's the university. I'm sure they also get private donations from alumni, especially famous alumni who now work in Hollywood, make a lot of money. They give money back to their university. We have a system in the United States whereby public universities that don't cost that much to go to, or I should say in Germany, for you, they would be a lot, but for us, they're not as much as the private ones. Alumni are a big source of money going back into the university. After people leave, they give money. So this archive is funded that way. It's a mixture of public and private money. And that is one archive that exists. And to your point, what you just said.
We also, of course, have these archives where gay films would go to, like we had the Bundesarchiv, but also the regional archives. But the Kinemathek in Berlin is very interested in lesbian and gay-themed films, and they kind of they have kind of fair contracts, right, what they would maybe do with these films. Even sometimes there's no release anymore, and they would preserve it, and all that is possible. One thing I wanted to say before this, what I forgot, is like what I just saw with the other film about James Baldwin, that in the US you have the right to citate for free, like as long as you kind of go with an argument and you use a little clip, like even from a Hollywood film, you may use it for free. In Germany, for example, this is all not possible. You have to pay almost for every second, and there are still maybe talks that this will be changed once, but this also makes it almost impossible for low budgets to make archival films. And you have to do them now because all the witnesses will, you know, won't be around in a couple of years.
I just wanted to say about that, my film was not made with any television money. My previous films were, but the situation's getting worse and worse to get money from television. But in terms of archive use in the United States, we have two positive things I can talk about. One is what Jochen's talking about is called fair use. It is not really... It's a gray area.
It's twisted.
It's a gray area. Yeah. It just means if they sue you for using their material, you can claim fair use. But they're very strict
limitations
on how you can use it. It has to be only a certain duration. It has to be in a way that you're commenting on it. Like, for example, I use in my film two television reports about the death of Franco. I didn't pay for them because... it would be more than my whole budget of the film. So if they come after me, they're all both very, very short. I'm going to claim that's fair use because it's not enough for me to say on the screen, Franco died. I need to put you in the era. So it's a kind of, there's an argument to be made of why I need to use it. I'm not claiming it. I shot it or it's mine, I'm stealing it. It's clearly from television, Walter Cronkite, most famous news reporter ever. But the other thing is, the other thing we have besides this fair use law is we have the National Archives in Washington, D.C. And we have, hopefully we will continue to have, this kind of funny idea in the United States that the government is supposed to belong to the people. Therefore, this is Founding Fathers' idea, we'll see how long that lasts. But because of that, the National Archives is not allowed to charge for archive material. Well, they still gouge you because you are not allowed to take the material and duplicate it yourself. You have to use their labs, which they overcharge for. But still, it's much, much better than having to pay copyright. So if you can find footage in the National Archives, I found this amazing footage of Carabanchel prison, political prisoners in that prison, in the National Archives in Washington in a kind of informational newsreel about what was happening inside Franco's Spain. So I could pay no copyright fees whatsoever for that material.
So, I mean, there exists something, and I mean, for kids now, it's not that difficult to Google queer people from history. We will find them. We did not have any identification people or like role models ourselves. Do you remember to start like, or like to go like in another direction? Do you remember when you first learned that one historical person was gay or lesbian? And maybe also, when did you decide yourself, well, I really have to work on making queer history visceral, so I make films about it. Did you remember? Do you remember that? And maybe, yeah, starting with you.
Well, I'm glad you gave me a little warning on this question. So I've been thinking about this, and I'm from New York City, but for the first maybe 12 years of my life, I lived in a suburb outside of New York City, which happened to be the same place as Walt Whitman was from on Long Island. And in typical American fashion, they had the Walt Whitman Shopping Center. And so around 12 was when I started my rebellious kind of cynicism and, you know, becoming radicalized. And I found this irony that they used the fact that Walt Whitman was from this town to name a shopping mall after him. I mean, I found this irony really incredible. And I think at that moment, I started discovering more about Walt Whitman and discovered that he was gay, which made the irony of the shopping mall even greater. So I think that was probably the first one. I think he was like the, and you know what's really interesting? I discovered Federico Garcia Lorca, of course, much later, who's a key figure in my film, but there's a very beautiful series of homages of Federico Garcia Lorca to Walt Whitman. So he wrote about Walt Whitman, and he also was a visual artist, and he did drawings. So it was kind of, for me, interesting to come full circle.
Do you remember your first?
I also was thinking. First, I wanted to say I don't recall anyone, neither in a bad connection nor in a good connection, but I think the first person I really adored, maybe by then I was kind of 16, 17, was maybe Pasolini, you know, mm-hmm. like also as a filmmaker and what he wrote. And then I also, because of that, I went to Italy. I wanted to study in Cinecittà, like Centro Sperimentale and, you know, these things.
And do you remember, like, when you first had the decision, okay, I will join this, I will do films about queer history, or there is a need, I have to do that?
Well, my first film that I worked on was Before Stonewall, some of you know it, and I got dragged into that. I didn't choose really to do it, but I was working at that time. My partner Greta Schiller was already working on that film, and she wanted me to start doing the research, because I was always kind of, not only by education, but just by inclination, a kind of a researcher and historian, and she knew this was going to be a huge, enormous, in fact, research job. So I got kind of roped into doing it, and of course fell in love with doing it, and the rest is history, as they say.
And you, Jochen, do you remember?
Of course, it must have been always the American documentaries. Also, Before Stonewall, for me, was a very important documentary, and also Harvey Milk, the documentary, and I think the Americans were first to really make these very impressive documentaries about lesbian gay figures, in a way. And of course, when you do a documentary, that's why I also do documentaries, I also did a couple of fiction films, they always also are documents or become documents immediately, first of all, because very often no one has ever filmed something about it, or not maybe in the length and depth or whatever. And therefore, at some point, you always meet these people, and then you always see, oh, what's always on television? All these millions and millions of heterosexual stories, and of all these people, nothing has been made. And that's why I, at some point, also started to do interviews which I preserved, like for example, in out in East Berlin, we only had like a couple of characters in the film, but we did another set of like 25, almost sometimes 4 hour long interviews with people, which we edited down to 1 hour, which are not yet published, but things where you think like, okay, someday these people won't be around, and if I don't do it, maybe no one else will do it. Not that I feel great about that I do it, it's just, also sometimes you feel that you are responsible to do this because you left this person out, and you know there's not a TV station coming next week and saying, did he already do this about you? Can we do it? Or because no one will ever come. And while other people in other parts of society are filmed and interviewed on and on and on. And so sometimes I feel that pressure, which is also sometimes a little bit heavy, that also sometimes when I leave people out of a story and I still know that this story is also good, I kind of promise or I do a little thing with them, and that's all now, you know, in my archives also.
So, I mean, it's good that we have role models as well nowadays, or kids have role models nowadays, but I was wondering, like, isn't it kind of like a little bit dangerous to claim people like historical figures or artists to be gay, to use them? Don't we maybe reduce them only on their sexuality, or do you reflect this danger in a way in your work?
There was a very interesting discussion after the Chavela film the other night. There was a woman in the, I don't know if anyone was there at the premiere of Chavela, but there was a woman in the audience from Mexico who was a little bit upset that the film gave so much attention to Chavela's homosexuality. Because after all, she's an artist and her art is the important thing. And I found this a fascinating discussion because there was a woman sort of from the other side of the theater who addressed the, you know, there was some tension in the room after this, and nobody really said anything. And then suddenly this woman said, you know, what's incredible about her art is her life that she brings to her art, and her passion, which comes from her suffering. It's, you can't separate out the fact that she was a lesbian and what she went through from who she is when she goes on the stage. And the whole audience erupted in applause. I mean, everyone felt really like, and especially in the case of Chavela, she's not fantastic because she has perfect pitch and, you know, the best voice ever. She's fantastic because she just, like, grabs you and, you know, and has such a power over you. And this comes from her own pain of her own experience. So I think this is, I just tell you this story because I think in this, maybe in smaller ways, in Chavela's case, it's very obvious, but I think in some ways it's true of everyone. You can't sort of separate out that this part of someone's life is not important, you know, because we're all a product of all of our experiences, and that part in particular has been the part that's been most erased over history, over years, and it's really important that we don't keep erasing it ourselves.
Maybe it's a little bit different with me since I didn't do documentaries about very famous persons, but more sometimes about themes, and a lot of persons like contribute to a theme or to a process or to a discourse with their contributions that they are in the film. So I never did a biographical film about a person who is famous for something and maybe also gay, you know, so but in your situation, of course, you will always run into this discussion, of course. Yeah,
I saw some people nodding and so please join if you have questions or if you want to add on one of the topics. I was mentioning already kind of like this weird movement worldwide, this backlash we just experienced, the kind of like new homophobia that we suffer. I was wondering, like, do you have any strategies to resist this backlash or to create solidarity? What do you think is important now to go on and not to, or like, yeah, to resist this backlash? Do you have any ideas, strategies, plans?
For me, you know, like even just a couple, you know, I've worked on my film Bones of Contention for many years, and even just a few months ago, it for me it was like an interesting, unknown piece of history. It was relevant to today, the historical memory movement, what Anthony is doing today is really important today, but it was a piece of history that wasn't known and needed a kind of a light shined onto it. But that was a few months ago, and everything's changed so fast in the United States especially, but because it's changed so fast in the United States, it has also global implications. I feel like my film has changed, and it was more about the past, and now I hope it's can be seen as a cautionary tale about the future, and maybe a little bit like a piece of resistance against what's happening. And I think it's so important. I just want to point out, you know, Sylvia Reyes and Anthony Ruiz and Sylvia Reyes again, because I feel so honored that they trusted me with their stories. I think future generations need to hear this.
I think so too. Jochen, what is your strategy, or I mean, continuing making films, of course. I hope we're going to see more and more films.
Well, I'd say, of course, historical films are very important, although we also know that also lesbians and gays are more sometimes interested in the present or in the future. For example, there had to come Americans to do the film Paragraph 175. It was not the Germans who did it. And the film had very, very few viewers in Germany, also among the gay community. And so it's always like this thing, like how do you interest people for this, and you still have to preserve it. I think without knowing how your own history is, you also can't really go over the obstacles which will come in future, and you can learn from processes, how did they do before. And for example, in Rainbow's End, Peter Tatchell, an activist from London, is saying, like, all these kind of right-wing things are happening again and again. So many people feel like, oh, it's not serious and it's just a little thing happening around, but it can be the same situation like in the 20s. And, you know, all these things are important if there's no material about it, and we are living in an audiovisual society nowadays, and life, I think, nothing will happen. But at the same time, films are not everything. I mean, films have to be accompanied by a lot of other action, and films can be sometimes maybe a starting point, or they can be a material for other people to attract interest in making another movement, or, you know, but a film is also not, sometimes I say, if a sack rice, we say in Germany, falls on one side in China, or a film is being made, it's almost the same. And we also know that we were impressed by so many incredible films and nothing changed in society, but still they're incredibly important because you have to reassure yourself as well. I mean, they are a thing of self-identification, reassurement, and historical films, really, that you have a heritage and that you have a history.
I mean, you just mentioned that this is all discussed within the queer community, and I mean, especially in Berlin, I feel like in a bubble, and sometimes I totally forget that we have to argue certain things. So, isn't it also important to, coming back to our topic today, our history books are exclusively heterosexual. I'm thinking about school history books, of course. Like, isn't it important to teach also queer history in schools? And I know about Berlin, queerhistory.de offers material for teachers to teach queer history in the schools, and it is also implemented in the curriculum here. How is the situation in the States about teaching queer history? Is it implemented in the curriculum, or are there groups that support this or offer material for schools?
In the United States, it really depends on what state you're in, because, I mean, my daughter, when she was in high school, she's in university now, but when she was in high school, she had a very progressive curriculum in her school, and it was a public school. It was not a private school, but it was a very progressive curriculum. The teachers were progressive. They made sure that African American history, LGBT history, women's history was part of the curriculum. She was really fortunate. I don't think that happens in many places. And I know that we were saying earlier, a huge section of the United States can't really even teach biology because they don't want to promote evolution. So you can't teach biology without evolution. So they kind of teach creationism in the public schools, in the public schools that our tax money goes to. And so if we can't even have biology, I think we're very far from having LGBT history. It's really a crisis, and you know, democracy only works if you have an educated populace. And you see what's happening now in the United States. We don't have an educated populace.
There's a question.
Hi, it's very, kannst du das Mic anmachen? Danke. Thank you very much for this really interesting, fascinating discussion. I didn't want to interrupt at this point. I just wanted to say we had a discussion before this. We had a panel where we talked also about the queer education in schools, and the panelists were from Sweden and Australia, and we discussed the same thing, but I wanted to quickly go back to something you said before. First of all, about the museum structure, the gay museums. I did research since 10 years ago. I wrote something about on the gay museum here in Berlin, and I researched if there are other gay museums, and that was for some time, and I wondered if you could help me out with this, the talk about a virtual museum or a real gay museum that never came into fruition. Do you have any knowledge about that? Or there was a talk about it, there was supposed to be a big thing, and there were headlines for about, I think, a year on queer websites, and then no one ever heard of that before. I wonder, it's just that came into my mind, and I can't, like, you know, I'm lacking some infos. I wonder if you've heard about this too and could comment on it. The other one was about the relevance of the sexuality of the artist in your film or in others. I was wondering about that. I could get your point, you know, that you reduce someone to their sexuality. What would you think about those artists who, like, never really came out, you know? Like, I'm thinking about Robert Rauschenberg or Jasper Johns, for example, where everyone knew they were queer. What would you say about those artists? Should we mention their sexuality? Because I understand the longing to not have an erasure again, because history erases it. Like, should we talk about that as well? Yeah, these are my two inputs. Sorry for being so long.
But you're not talking about the Legacy Project, no? It's not the Legacy Project.
It was something else. I think it was called a virtual queer gay museum, and it was a big buzz, and was funded, and all of a sudden it disappeared completely. You couldn't
read. Who was organizing it?
And this is the thing I don't have in the back of my head.
Unfortunately, I know, like, what you said. I don't know. I can't add to it. I do remember that it was, you know, something that was a lot, had quite a bit of momentum behind it. I can't really add anything. I do remember, but I.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And what about, like, his second question, outing artists, or like even like historical figures, I don't know, like to talk about them and mention that they might have been gay or lesbian.
You think they will get over it? Especially when they're dead.
There are historic, you know, to come out or not come out is not just a personal choice. It's circumscribed by historical conditions, right?
Yeah, totally.
You know? I mean, if someone today chooses not to come out, that maybe that's a personal choice in this climate. But I mean, everyone lives within whatever the confines of their time. I mean, Laura Garcia Lorca in my film says Lorca lived his life fairly openly as a gay man. Of course, what that meant then to be open in a conservative society. So, you know, it's not necessarily that, okay, this person made a choice not to come out and we should respect this. That's respecting this. That is equivalent to respecting the society that did not let that person come out.
And that's even today. I mean, a friend of mine did a 1-hour documentary for Art about Tchaikovsky, really focusing also on him being gay and at the same time Russia, because it's their, you know, biggest musician tries to cover this whole thing up, and so you really see it's also a political thing which still is very alive.
There is a question.
I remembered a thought from the Black History that refers to this subject. Beethoven, it's a big discussion. Was he black or was he not black? And but with the research, I found now that he himself made a decision to erase that memory, but because there was no photos then. So he had portraits made of him that made him white, because he had a, he knew that when people would look at him as a black person, that they would not acknowledge his music, and he wanted to really support his music, and this was his decision to make that big. But I mean, just imagine. So it's hardly possible to find anything about it to prove that he was black. Only the first pictures you can see in his face, and there are some hints, but that's what I mean, you know, if we don't discover it and uncover it, it might be lost forever. And why is it important, as your films show? If we have no legacy, no history, we are swimming in this vacuum, and we need it.
And a second,
and the future kids need it.
The second thing is also that, for example, in the film with James Baldwin, I think it's not very much pointed out in the film that much that he's gay, but you always can feel it. And it also shows like that also gays and lesbians were important members on many social and political movements, and usually society tries to reduce gay and lesbian people to like only for their own sexual fun, or that this is all only their little bubble they want to live in. But when you always point out where they did other contributions to things, and that they were right in the middle, and is even sometimes leading factors, the other side, you know, it's important.
That's curious. I haven't had a chance to see I'm Not Your Negro yet, and I love Raoul Peck's films, but James Baldwin was very out himself in a time when it wasn't that easy for him to be out. So it's curious that you say the film doesn't really...
No, it does. It does. It does. It doesn't cover it at all, but it's really more a film about the really the whole issue of the American society with black heritage.
It's about
and
the
race,
black movement,
you know,
but
and
it's not hidden.
And I
right?
think otherwise it would have been, one would have... It would have had to be 15 or 20 minutes longer,
or a different
hour
film,
or whatever,
yeah.
or a different film. Okay. So it's totally, I'm totally fine
Glad
with it.
You clarified.
Totally, I'm totally fine with the film.
There is another question or a comment.
I want to make one little comment, which is when Walt Whitman, in general, became known as gay, I would guess your mall is no longer called that. Right, they removed his name from many high schools. They removed his name from all sorts of institutions across the United States, which I find exceedingly tragic. That's my one little comment. I wondered, is it okay to ask questions of the eyewitnesses we have here today?
Yes,
sure, I think so, yeah.
Because I have a question for Tony and Sylvia. I mean, this film has just come out. It's been exceedingly difficult to talk about the Franco era anyway, let alone now, from a gay perspective. And I worry a bit for you. What are you going to face difficulties now in Spain, perhaps, because of being so out in this film? And if so, how can we support you?
Could you please pass him the microphone, maybe?
Bueno, buenas tardes, buenos días. No sé, porque en Berlín 5 minutos parece que es ir a la luna, ¿no? En fin, yo quería, en primer lugar, creo que el movimiento LGTB hoy en día en España no va a correr mucho más riesgo que corra un movimiento en Francia o en Alemania. Seguimos sufriendo homofobia por muchos sectores de la sociedad. Pero bueno, lo llevamos con mucha dignidad y evidentemente siempre le plantamos cara a esa homofobia. Estamos muy de acuerdo en que hay que empezar a educar a nuestros niños en la diversidad, porque es muy importante, ¿no? Es decir, porque cuando estos niños crezcan habrán aceptado tanto a lesbianas, homosexuales, personas de color, no de color y todas estas cuestiones. No creo que tengamos problemas, vamos, para entrar en nuestro país por haber hecho la película. Al revés, tendremos algunos que otros reconocimientos. Lo que...
Yeah, so he said that he doesn't think he will have problems to go back to Spain and cross the frontier just because he's made this film, that he, well, people in Spain faces the same homophobia that it's experienced in Germany or Italy or other European countries or other countries in the world, and that, well, he doesn't think that that he'll have to face, like, more than he's already faced so far. So, yeah, he's not that afraid of that. So you can be reassured that nothing that bad is going to happen, probably.
Silvia?
Ha habido otro tema importante sobre la cuestión de los archivos y la digitalización de los archivos. En España, en el 2000, conseguimos que todos los archivos judiciales penitenciarios de lesbianas, homosexuales y transexuales los dejara de tener el Poder Judicial y pasaran a los archivos históricos. Es cierto que está reducido su visita a ellos. Seguimos luchando por ello y creo que en breve lo vamos a conseguir.
He says that it's difficult to have access, and the access to the archives in Spain is not that easy, but we're still fighting so that we have a more, well, an easier access to this kind of archives.
Es bastante complicado porque son distintos gobiernos, como sabéis, son bastantes gobiernos autonómicos. Pero bueno, tenemos el apoyo de algunos y evidentemente lo vamos a conseguir. Igual que hemos conseguido que se pusieran los presupuestos generales del Estado 4 millones de euros para indemnizar a los homosexuales, lesbianas y transexuales que fueron represaliados, ¿no? Ahora tenemos la suerte de que Alemania ha seguido los mismos pasos, ha puesto más dinero, evidentemente 30 millones de euros. Pero vamos, supongo que esta película nos va a ayudar a conseguir el resto y poderles otorgar una vida digna, la que jamás se les tuvo que robar, y devolverles su dignidad y que vivan con sus últimos días, pues, con la dignidad que se merecen como seres humanos, nada más.
He says we're still fighting so that the people from the LGBT community who were imprisoned during the Franco regime are paid for the harm that was made to them, and that we've got like 4,000 euros so far, not as good as Germany, who has paid like 30,000 euros. But we hope that this film will help us like get more money to fund these people who were in prison during the time.
Thanks for this information. So if you also want to say some words, we have to make it short because we're running out of time. Can we extend actually or? Okay.
Hola, yo soy Silvia, activista del colectivo transexual de Barcelona y de lesbianas y de gays. Es que como habéis visto en el documental anoche, explicaba mi estancia en prisiones españolas en la dictadura del generalísimo por Franco. Y es que quería decir que el colectivo transexual es que es el más discriminado del mundo entero. Y desgraciadamente hasta el día de hoy pues nos siguen discriminando y agresiones en todas partes, y en Europa, y es que en todas partes. Y seguiremos luchando a ver si con los años pues mejoramos un poquito y nos respetan más y las autoridades pues nos tienen más en cuenta.
She says she is a part of the Association of Transsexuals in Barcelona, and that she is fighting so that the transsexuals in Spain can have like a better life, and that they are respected and they're not as followed and left aside from the society and excluded as it's been until now. Like she hopes it's gonna be better with their fight. And with the film, it will help, probably.
Yeah, thanks. I think it's interesting also in your film to see, and I think you just like also mentioned it, that trans people very often in the fight, like in historical, are always in the front line. It was Stonewall, it was like also like, as you mentioned, I think that's a important topic as well, because...
And it's proven in the photos that you were in the front line.
It's proven in the photos.
And trans people, yeah.
Yeah. There was one question, yes. Do we have like a microphone? Could you pass the microphone, please, to over there? There is the microphone, yes, please.
Hi, thank you both for your important work. My question is about lesbians, and it's to both of you. Dr. Weiss, you mentioned that you found in your research that lesbians were especially hidden in the story, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the difficulties you face, or maybe more about the strategies you found to overcome these difficulties and to make these women talk. Another question is, did you only talk, or were you only able to talk to activists who had told their stories many times, or were you able to talk to people or listen to people who hadn't talked so much about their lives? And my question for Jochenik is, are lesbians part of your story of West Berlin? I haven't seen your movie yet. And what are the challenges that you faced? Thank you.
Maybe first, like in Out in East Berlin, which I did together with Andreas Strohfeld, we had lesbians and gay people together in one film, because also we saw them very much connected throughout that time in the GDR, maybe there were also less places to go, so there was kind of a little bit more kind of a joint movement, although there were also these separations that lesbians were astonished about gays always talking about their topics and not in neglecting theirs. It's not Out in West Berlin, but in my wonderful West Berlin, we only show why the lesbians at some point left the gay movement. But I think it needs another film, because we already have 14 characters, and it would have been horribly superficial to do this about, to put another 14 characters in. And I think it deserves a film I would like to see. I don't want to see my film about lesbian history from the 50s to the 80s. I really want to see it made by lesbians, especially because I also want to see all the kind of social and sexual workings about their clubs they had, you know, what this whole thing like pro, you know, pro porn, contra porn, pro sex, contra sex, and, you know, and going with the women's movement and some not, and, you know, all these things, and have the access to it. I think someone else should do. It's not, I wouldn't be the perfect person for that. And therefore, we kind of, at the end, we have this outlook, like the film ends with the lesbians marching through Schöneberg, which is supposed to be the very, very gay area, the most gayish area in Berlin, and they're doing their Dyke March, they did it in 2016 in Schöneberg, and with the question, where are the lesbians? Because it was all this talk also about, like, how visual are lesbians? Are they visual enough? Why aren't they visual? There are these discussions, and I think I just wanted to shed a light on it, but also that I think a woman's or a lesbian, heterosexual woman or a lesbian woman would be, or even trans, you know, would be better to do this than a gay man, you know.
So there are connections between gay and lesbian history, but maybe you want to point out what, like, to the question what she said, like, was it difficult for you to approach lesbian?
Well, You know, when I started working on this film, Bones of Contention, it was never my idea to make a kind of Spanish before Stonewall. You know, I wasn't really looking for, like, the whole spectrum of LGBT experience. It was more of an essay film for me. And I think I wanted, of course, the lesbian element to be part of it, but I wasn't, like, when I was... I made many films about lesbian history, Paris Was a Woman and Tiny and Ruby, where I went and found, you know, lesbians to talk about their lives, found images and so on. This really had a different motivation, but I still, of course, wanted the lesbian presence in it. And the main thing that lesbians, any lesbian I talk to, would talk about is their invisibility. It's very hard to show invisibility. And you can't really make a film when you can only talk about something and not show it. You know, we're trying to show it. So I found, I knew Isabel Frank. She was a good friend of mine already. So, I mean, obviously I knew she could talk about it. But, and I met Empar Pineda, in part through Anthony. And I felt like they could represent that story. And when I met this woman who wouldn't appear on film and she wouldn't appear on, and there were a couple of others like her who wouldn't appear. I decided, okay, that's not where this film can go. Maybe someone who's Spanish, whose Spanish is better than mine, who can make have a tighter connection with some of these women. Maybe before they die, they could coax them to be in a film. But that wasn't my film. So my bigger job was to try and find kind of unusual ways to make the invisible visible. And so I found, you know, the woman's story when she talks about the booksellers, I found archive footage. There's a moment in the film where I have very few graphic images. I have some photographs and I have all their names on the screen. I'm telling you, that's all there was. I had nothing else to work with. It's a really hidden history. But I felt it was important, even with very little to work with, that it be mentioned.
But that would maybe also, oh, there is a question.
Hello, thank you very much. I think this is a very interesting discussion that we're having today. My question is of a technical nature, because in the earlier discussions, we've been talking about why the LGBT community gets very worked up with resentment and even animosity to projects like The Imitation Game, which is done by straight directors. And so this is in fiction, but in documentary, can we as the LGBT community entrust this documentation of history to straight people, or are there documentaries from about the LGBT communities which are very well done by heterosexuals?
Well, I can't give you any examples, but I tell you, when back in the 1980s, when I made Tiny and Ruby with my partner Greta Schiller, we got some resistance to white women going in to make film about African American lesbians, and I got a little friction when I dared, as an American, to make a film about the Mann family, Erica and Klaus Mann, like, what do I know? Yeah. And I was expecting a little, I think one of the great gifts of being a documentary filmmaker is that you can enter worlds that you don't know, and you can learn about them, and I mean, I think that's one of the great things. I don't want to be restricted to make films only about, like, my little narrow experience and people who are just like me. I mean, so I have to extend that same right to other filmmakers. And then, of course, you know, you all can decide whether you think that that film did justice to the subject or not. But I think, you know, I had a little trepidation making this film about Spain, mm-hmm. because I'm not Spanish. And in fact, kind of like what you said, if I saw any Spanish people stepping forward and making it, I'd be happy to step back, but there was no one, you know. So I think that I don't think we need to be constricted in that way as documentary filmmakers, but I do feel we need to earn the trust and the respect of the people who are entrusting us with their stories. We need to be very careful with them, and we need to do our best to, you know, they're not our stories. We're the storyteller, but it's their story, and we need to respect that.
But just for the record, do you know personally of any significant, relevant documentation told by a non-LGBT community person?
I don't know that much, but I mean, before there were no theatrical documentation, it was mostly television, so you only can look for the countries where you would be able to do a topic about it. It was not the GDR, we have to say, although they didn't have paragraph 175 at some point. And it was, of course, not Spain, because, you know, who would, under Franco, this wouldn't happen. So when you go into the television archives, for example, what I can say about Germany, West Berlin, West Germany, you find sometimes, I don't know if these people were gay or not gay, but you find sometimes documentaries, even in the 60s, where you would say, I mean, even sometimes gay people nowadays would be more behind in their approach to document it, and it might have been a straight person. So I think this can always happen, but I also would say that I sometimes call my films a little bit like, you know, more for a little bit advanced in the way, like, also gay people have an interest not to always see films which are approachable from all audiences, because we also want to go in depth in our themes. And when we always start to make all accessible for all straight people and always describe and explain from the very first stone why this is, and because very often straight say so quickly, oh, I feel excluded from this or that film because I'm not addressed directly and not everything is explained to me. We also need this niche products where we really can go in depth into our discussions, and therefore documentaries are a good means, because documentaries are not that expensive, but they are still expensive enough that also lesbian and gay people, the whole queer community, should appreciate it as much that maybe sometimes they would maybe spend some money into very important projects that they can be done. So this is also something, because not everything comes from Arte, which would come from a lesbian or a gay filmmaker who would do it independently, I can assure you.
I just have a short
one thing. Short last question,
yeah,
because
short,
we are,
no, it's
like,
it's not a question. It's not a question. Oh, because I read something this morning and I thought it was very relevant to the discussion today, because they say that especially LGBT artists or the directors doing films, we usually, or LGBT people who are active in the society, that they are not living in a bubble, we have two narratives in our head. We have a language that the society speaks, but we have a second narrative that is running, which we use. It's like an insider language for the LGBT language. And we switch the channels when we communicate with the outer world and with the inner world. So I think that's very true. It's when will we reach that stage where we can speak one language?
I think no minority can ever reach that stage, because every minority has so many specialties that you will always leave some people out. But I think the minority has to decide by itself on which level it wants to discuss its own things and still go and confront the rest of society and show the rest of society what's going on. I think that's important at the same time.
I mean, let's maybe at the end become utopian and maybe there will be no minorities or whatever, or like, as I said, like, I would wish that, like, in 20, 30, 40 years, people would laugh about fucking different films, my films that I did, because, like, oh, look, they were so funny, they were still, like, gay and lesbian, and they were marginalized. What would be your wish, your biggest wish for the future? Or, like, utopia?
I think that's too hard a question. But yes. I just think maybe it's not such a... Maybe what you're talking about, this two languages, is a plus, not a minus. It could be a something.
And you, Jochen?
I also think it enriches society, that also some individuals are different than others and that they are assured about their identity, not becoming identitarian, of course, but knowing about their identity. And therefore, I think it's always the majority looks about people who are less than them as a minority. This is always a rule in society. I think this will never end. I think so, but maybe other people think it's not like that.
Yeah, and maybe we at a certain point we don't have to discuss minorities and diversity anymore, but maybe just like start celebrating diversity. And in this sense, I would like to thank you for your
contributions. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you very much for listening to us.